This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
We've got a great guest today on Dreamland, someone who's been with us many times, and you're going to love it because we're going to be talking to, and here he comes, Preston Dennett's back with us. Humanoids and High Strangeness. This is super right in the middle in the depths of Preston Dennett's wheelhouse. Preston is really into the whole idea of humanoids and high strangeness and things like that. And this new book, Humanoids and High Strangeness, is 20 UFO encounters, true, in the sense that these are what the people have reported. And you can find out more about it on Preston's YouTube channel. And because he's got a very active YouTube channel, he has his own podcast on the channel, and is planning to, I think, get into audio podcasting as well soon. So he's a going guy, and he seems to have a book out about every 10 days. But they're good books. They're so enjoyable. Getting into these stories is important, because the more of this that we see and read, the better we are at untangling our own perceptions when and if this happens to us. So anyway, welcome to Dreamland, Preston Dennett.
Thanks, Whitley. Always a pleasure.
It's always a pleasure to have you here. Preston, I have discovered, has chickens. He and Dolly, who has been on Dreamland before with her own extraordinary experiences. But the chickens aren't in this show, sadly enough. I wanted to bring him in, but he wouldn't do it. Okay. Humanoids and High Strangeness. You know, I asked for some specific stories that Preston really wanted to talk about. But there's one that you didn't send me about, Joseph Wandrika. This is a story that took place in Vienna back in 1954, and it really stuck out in this for me, because there was another case in Brazil which was extensively studied by Jacques Vallée, of a young man who did the same thing. So let's talk first about that case, the Joseph Wandrika case.
Yeah, I like that case. That's one I looked into. I didn't personally interview the witness, but what a fascinating case. It absolutely caught my attention, because here's a young man who is a political activist in his country of Austria, and would often moped around the country and was out in the forests. This is south of Vienna, I believe. And he's a young man and sees this glint of metal along this forest path where he's driving his little moped, and is curious because he had seen UFOs before and wondered what they were. And came upon this craft, which was actually landed. It had a ramp coming down to the ground, was well lit inside with a bright yellow light. And he could see about six figures, quite short, very youthful looking, really beautiful, what we might call Nordics. I don't really like that term because it's a bit misleading, I think, because some of them do have dark skin. In this case, they didn't. They were all blonde haired, blue eyed, very youthful looking, wearing jumpsuits without any buttons or anything on them, and appeared to be waiting for him, which he found curious. And he just drove right up to them, and they seemed very welcoming. So he actually took his moped and drove it up the ramp right into the entrance of the craft. And he said it was quite surprising. And like many witnesses, he said that there was really not a whole lot in there in terms of equipment or consoles or anything like that, and very well lit with indirect lighting. But what I love about this case is they started speaking to him with quite a long conversation, he introduced himself and basically said where he lived. And they also replied saying that they were from the highest star in the Cassiopeia constellation. I thought that was interesting. I looked up that star. It's quite larger than ours. There's no known exoplanets, but interesting nevertheless. And he started kind of complaining to them about the state of the world at that time, which was, you know, I believe this was the late 1940s. This is a pretty early case. And lots of political unrest. And he was complaining about how politicians are ruling the world, and it's all greed and corruption and famine and disease. And could they intervene? And they said, no, no, we can't intervene. You are in a much better position as a citizen of this planet to change things. We have no intentions of doing anything like that.
That's still true as far as I know.
Exactly. Yeah, I've heard
that. You know, people keep thinking, oh, they'll come and save us. Somehow I doubt that very much. I think it's up to us. This is our place, and it's we do it here or we don't. And they will watch us, and they will interact with us. And in fact, like this is a case of interaction. Another one that happened, the reason I wanted to talk about this case is the Vilas Boas case in Brazil in 1957, which has got a lot of similarities, including, well, the first entities he saw weren't humanoid, really. They were, but then he found himself with a very beautiful woman, and inside the ship as well, and had an equally equivocal experience. And it's as if someone was sort of had found us and was looking around in various places very carefully. In other words, they were not as secretive, perhaps, as they are now, because maybe back then they hadn't been shot at so much. But anyway, they aren't as secretive as they are now, and they're kind of snooping around and seeing people in different places. I thought that was a very interesting comparison, that the two would be so similar. But the coolest part of the story, of course, is he chooses to drive the moped in instead of walk. I just love it. That's also a little detail that makes you think this in some way probably is a true story, because who would say that if it didn't happen? Because it sounds so crazy. It sounds exactly like the last thing you would do. I'd say, well, I put my moped aside and walked up the ramp. But instead, he drives up the ramp.
Now, there's quite a few little details in it that really make me think this did happen. Because he described how when he left, he spun his moped around and the floor was like smooth ice. It's just very, very no friction almost at all, which is something I have heard from other people. Little details like that. They seem very interested in his moped, which I found fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah, God, I was interested in mopeds in 1957, too. But when you say frictionless and other cases, can you elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, people have. There was one guy, Jay Gardner, I think, described how the floor was almost like glass. It's the smoothest thing he's ever felt. And the entities that he saw were just actually glide across it. He had to walk, but they just glided right across it. And I've heard that sort of description, that the floor is in the walls, for that matter. Another guy, Tim from Louisiana, felt the walls because he said these were the smoothest things I've ever felt. It's smoother than glass. So you can imagine. I mean, they struggle for words, I think. That's another thing I find very fascinating, because there are no words to describe some of the stuff you're experiencing. And that smoothness comes up a lot.
The metallurgist Robert Sauerbacher who died the 2 days after I talked to him in 1986, told me, and he's known to have, he went public with the fact that he'd worked on the Roswell materials. In other words, there's letters and so forth that you can easily find on the internet now. And he was introduced to me by Stanton Friedman, because I was looking at that point when I was writing Communion for some kind of physical evidence of some sort of this. And he said a very interesting thing. He said the molecules in the metal were arranged in an artificially created grid, and that was what made the metal so strong. And I wonder if it also made it extremely smooth.
Could very well be.
Yeah, he said it was not something that we could do. So anyway, it seems like something was happening back in the 50s, and it made me wonder if some of the early contactees with their Venusians and so forth, which we always dismiss as imaginary because they're so sort of silly, if we're dealing with something much larger, that there was a worldwide attempt by somebody who looked somewhat like us to explore kind of what we were. It's interesting that, maybe those stories from the 50s need to another look taken, maybe a very careful analysis of the details of the stories would cause some consistencies to emerge that we've always assumed just weren't there.
Yeah, I 100% agree. I think a lot of researchers have dismissed the whole contactee era of the 1950s. George Adamski, Howard Menger, Truman Bethlehem, Daniel Fry. There's quite a few of them.
Right.
And I don't think it disappeared. I think it was kind of pushed underground by a lot of the reports of the Grays. But, you know, I'm getting a lot more of these human-looking ET reports as time goes on.
So, are you seeing recent ones?
Well, relatively. Let me see. In terms of recent, I would say the most recent I have would be, I'd have to look into that, 2013. There's one case.
But that's very recent. Because I used to have them too until something happened in the 1990s that we're not talking about that today, although I'm going to get into it extensively in the book I'm writing, that changed it profoundly for me. And after that, I wondered if there were even, if they'd been thrown out by the Grays in a sense. But maybe not.
It's one of the common types, for sure. I mean, there's Grays, praying mantis, human-looking. That's mostly what I hear.
Yeah. Well, you know, you speak of praying mantises. Why don't we talk about Mother Mantis next? But before we do that, we're going to take a little break. We'll be right back. Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010, talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia.
Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. What happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I work with with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started.
Because we have these other beings that begin to come in a little later, actually. I don't think there's too many stories of greys or mantis beings or any kind of non-human entities before the early 60s, if I'm not correct. There are a few. I have seen a few, but not many. But then in that period, there's the humanoid stories drop off a bit, and then the non-humanoid stories sort of increase. I guess 1945, the Trinity incident that Jacques Vallée and Paola Harris studied is an early instance of that. But tell us the story of Mother Mantis. It's such a good one.
Yeah, I love the story of the lady. She's become quite a good friend. Her name is Sandra. She doesn't want her last name used. But an amazing account, because hers happened in New Mexico, Albuquerque, actually, in 1947, the summer of 1947. And she believes her father may have been involved in researching the Roswell incident, because he was called there, and he was quite highly placed in the Navy.
But, you know, I just stop for a second. General Exon's description of what he held in his arms was, as he put it, a big insect.
Oh, really?
And yeah. So he told them, those were his exact words. And I was supposed to never tell anything about the bodies, but things have changed so much that I'm beginning to talk about it a little bit, even though I said to him at the time I wouldn't tell about them. They were very secretive about the bodies for some reason. And the 1945 instance, the same type of being. So go ahead. And this is just the right time period.
Yeah. I mean, I wonder if there's a connection there, because.
Well, yeah.
Apparently, yeah. I mean, it was the exact same time period. And Sandra had grown up with some pretty unusual experiences when she was in her crib. She does not remember this, but her mother saw her levitating above the crib, completely freaked her out and said, who's ever doing this? Put her down.
Yeah. There's nothing like a levitation to upset your parents.
So she was having all kinds of, you know, remote viewing at a very young age and other unusual experiences where she would have a being talk to her and explaining about the human body. But at age 8, she had a friend who lived about a mile away on the local Native American reservation. and she asked her mom, which she had done many times, if she could bike there. This was a sort of a small little highway outside of Albuquerque. And her mom said, of course. So this was in the early morning. Sandra sets off to drive the 1 mile to her friend's house and doesn't get there. Her journey is interrupted when this craft drops down on the highway in front of her. And it's not super large, maybe 20 feet across, about the width of the highway. And she can see it's metallic, and a door opens up, and there, standing in the door, is a what we would call mantid or praying mantis. Now she's looking at it thinking, well, this is a big, tall bug that is walking like a person.
Right.
But it was friendly. She says it felt friendly, and it kind of motioned to her, gestured to come closer, which she did, and she was very curious. She felt no fear at all, and this bug-like being said, come on board. I am your mother. You can call me mother.
That's so fascinating. That's a very big moment there. Go tell us what you think about that.
Yeah, well, it's something I have heard before. I mean, this is exactly, Dolly said this. Her main ET contact said, you can call me mama. And I had a few other people after putting out that book, Symmetry, call me and says, you know what? I had the same experience.
What can it mean? Because there's at least one case where, a huge case in them, where this woman and her child, her little three-year-old, are taken aboard a craft and told that the people in the craft are their family.
Yes. I can kind of look at this a couple of different ways. One, that genetically, yes, that they may actually have some genetics in them. Because it turns out, I asked Sandra, and this is a pattern that you know well, this is generational. And her mother wouldn't talk about it. But Sandra's grandmother said, oh, yes, I was visited by beings when I was a little girl around your age. So there could be an actual physical relationship there. Or I suppose it could be a past life thing, or just, I don't know. There's still a lot of questions surrounding all this. But that was just a bit of information that really struck me profoundly. Because it's such an odd thing for an ET.
Yeah. But another thing that's not uncommon is very early childhood recall, which Sandra has. I have that too, and I know lots of abductees who have recall going in some cases back to before they were born, and the whole process of coming into the womb and being born, which I also have. And I mean, what could that be about? Is it because there's something about these people, or is it something about the experience that unlocks these early memories?
I don't know. I tend to think it is the person, that this is one of the reasons they follow genetic lines.
Yeah.
These are people who, I heard it so many times. Sandra talks about remembering stuff all the way up to just a couple of months old.
Yes.
I cannot remember this conversation that she had a fight on a local bus, and Sandra was able to relate the argument, and she was only a few months old. A lot of contactees have eidetic memories.
That's another thing. Explain what eidetic means.
Yeah, well, Mary Lou Henner, the famous actress, is well known for this. And I have at least three contactees in this latest book who have a photographic memory. Can remember everything it comes right to them. Word,
right.
Even, the pages in a book. It's definitely a pattern that I've seen now that I know to look for it.
I'd pay for the memory like that. I'd pay a lot of money for a memory like that. but unfortunately, that's not my case. Now, her life goes on, and does she have more experiences with these beings or with other beings?
with other beings. Well, you know, when she was pulled on board, she did see grays as well. Mm-hmm. She thought at first were little children because, you know, there wasn't any talk of grays. But she's looking at them like bald heads, large dark eyes. They were very playful, kind of chirping at her, touching her hair, leading her around the craft. And they showed her a hologram of future wars and, you know, scenes of battles and explosions and gunfire, and basically warned her against that, which seemed to be the whole purpose, or at least part of it, of the contact.
But one of these hopeless warnings that we get so many of. I say hopeless because what could she do about it?
Yeah, that was her exact thought, because she's like, I'm 8 years old. What do you want me to do? Exactly. She did not tell her parents about this. I asked her why not. She says, are you kidding? Even at that age, I knew I would not be believed. But she was missing for like 3 hours. They went back and forth along the highway looking for her, and she was not there. They went a fourth time and found her there lying next to the highway, unconscious or in a daze. Her memory starts back in the house where she's suddenly comes back to awareness.
Do you find that a lot of people who have childhood experiences tend to be secretive about them with their families?
Yes. Yeah.
I agree with you.
Some will mention it, and often, more often than not, they're disbelieved. It's a rare parent who embraces this. I'd say now it's much more common.
The thing that's so strange is that mostly children will tell their parents anything that's disturbing to them, but not this. This goes unspoken.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it can go unspoken all the way through adulthood. It's not unusual for people who I interview to say, listen, no one in my family knows. More often they will tell a spouse, but that's about it.
Very understandable, though, that they would do that because of all of the social control that has made this it's a real problem, an experience like this. But the thing is, children don't know about that kind of social control. I mean, when you're an adult, it certainly makes sense to not tell anyone about it because you don't want to make a fool of yourself. But as a child, it's almost as if there's another level that is telling them, you know, don't do this. Be careful. Keep it to yourself. And I wonder why that would be. What is this? Why is it so secretive? Do you have any sense of that? And I know it's a huge question, and it's not just about these cases, but in all of your work, you've come across the secrecy the same way I have and others have in many, many, many different ways. Give me an idea of where you think it comes from.
I wish I knew, but I absolutely agree with you. ETs. There's a lady in California who told me that, a lady up in Maine, where the ET says, do not talk about this. The time is not right. And then at some point, the time is right. And then they say, you need to go step forward and talk about this. This is your mission. So there's a complete 180-degree turn that sometimes does take place. So I think it might be out of protection for the witness. That the ETs know that this is not going to go over well if you try to talk about this. It's a lot of stress on a person just having the encounter itself, whereas having to deal with the reaction from people who are, you know, your family members and your friends, certainly society, puts a double whammy on people. So we do see this in a number of cases where the ETs will say, you're not going to remember this, you'll remember later. So I think that also connects to this of keeping it secret. But I don't know. I mean, this is why I do this research, because there's just so many questions surrounding all of these experiences.
Yeah, it was really secret when I was a child. I wouldn't ever tell anybody about it. And my dad was involved, and I wish I had understood this, because by the time I was 14. I had, by the time I was in high school, freshman high school, completely forgot all of it. Completely forgot it. Did not have any memory of it at all. Now I wish I had been able to bring it up with my dad, because he facilitated a lot of contact for me. And I'm wondering if you have many cases where parents and children have had mutual contact and do share with each other.
Certainly it comes up. There's one case in the book which is extraordinary, because it involved this gentleman. His name is Richard Simon, who at age 7 suddenly could not sleep, had absolute insomnia, and never could figure out why, other than a fear of intruders. And finally, as a young adult, age, I think it was 20 or so, his mom decided to stop smoking by going to a hypnotherapist. His mom's name was Ines. And I interviewed both of them. And she's like, why don't you, Richard, come with me? And the hypnotherapist can help with your insomnia. So they were going for these mundane reasons to this hypnotherapist. But what came out instead was a mutually shared encounter.
That must have been quite a surprise.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. She went in first, and he could hear her crying through the walls of the office. And she comes out after an hour, very teary-eyed. And he's like, what's wrong, Mom? She's like, I don't want to talk about it. It's your turn. You go in. And yeah, he recalled being taken on board at age 7. And she was there. She was in the other room. They were both being examined. And what's really interesting to me is with this case, he actually contacted you, by the way, and you responded very kindly, he said.
I did.
Yes.
Well, that letter, therefore, probably is in the archive, because we couldn't respond to all the letters, unfortunately, because there were tens of thousands of them. But any letter we responded to definitely is now in the archive in it at Rice University.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
So it's there.
Well, you definitely had an influence on him, because his mom said, well, you know what, Richard, when I was 7 years old, I saw humanoids. She was in the barn. And of course, he grew up, had kids. And when his child was 7, she came running into the room, dropped her Barbies and said, Dad, Dad, pointing to the TV where there was a gray ET. She's like, that's who came into my room and poked me in the nose. She was suffering from nosebleeds. Now, of course, she grew up. She has a 10-year-old child right now, but 3 years ago, when her child was 7, starts complaining about the monkey man, the bald monkey man looking into the window and coming into her room. So that's 4 generations of people who've shared encounters at age 7.
We're going to talk more about this in just a minute. We're taking another brief break. My new book, Them, has now been out since March of 2023. I would like to thank everyone for the wonderful reception, those who have read it, who have posted thoughtful reviews on Amazon, those who have listened. It's an important book for me. And also, over the months, it has become a very strange book, because if you listen to the Oversight Committee UAP hearings, you will hear David Grusch saying things almost sound like they were taken right out of the second part of Them. And I thought to myself, how did I do that? And the answer is, I have no idea. But the book is really very prophetic. And I think you should read it if you hadn't done so. And that's what this is all about. Read it, listen to it. It's really worth your time. Jacques Vallée certainly thought so. Mitch Horowitz thought so. Jeff Kripal thought so. Leslie Kane, Diana Pasolka, and all of the others who gave it blurbs thought so, and so do an awful lot of people who have reviewed it. So pick up a copy today. Go to Amazon and get a copy. Go to Audible and get the audiobook. Listen to them. Read them. It's a whole new vision of how we should think about the close encounter experience, and this is getting more and more important over time. More and more important. Them. I saw the future when I was writing that book, Didn't know I would, but I did. You can read it now and see for yourself. We're talking to Preston Dennett. His new book, so cool, Humanoids and High Strangeness, 20 True UFO Encounters. And Preston is a good researcher. He's like all good researchers. He tries his best when he says true UFO encounters. There are many multiple witness encounters in here, which helps. And the ones that aren't multiple witness encounters, as we've been to an extent discussing, have elements that do suggest that there is some kind of accuracy in these reports. But, you know, one of the things that happens in the sort of external community is the assumption that, oh, we're just a bunch of nuts making things up or publicity hounds and so forth. And it's so far from the truth. Actually, what this is a testament of real human experience of some kind. And that gets me to a question. If this isn't ET, what do you're bound to have thought about other possibilities. And can you give me some ideas about what they may be?
Yeah, well, I'm a big believer that it is extraterrestrial after having just tried to find other explanations. That's still the one that to me rings truest and best explains the evidence. But a lot of stuff does get put under the UFO umbrella, which I think perhaps doesn't belong there. I think there probably are interdimensional beings. There's one guy in the book who I don't think he saw an ET. I think he saw an elf or something along those lines, a gnome, interdimensional, if you will, supernatural being, what you might call a crypto-terrestrial, which has been here all along and might be considered an ET or interpreted that way when I don't think it is. So I think that does come up. I think some people who think they're seeing ETs probably saw an angelic figure of some kind. Because if you have a glowing being that comes into your room and heals you, how do you interpret that? So I don't think they're time travelers from the future. There is, of course, a very popular explanation that this is an interdimensional intelligence that wears different masks, sort of along the lines of John Keel and Jerome Clark and Jacques Vallée.
I think Jeff Kripal would be in that camp too.
Yeah, which I'm not going to completely rule that out.
No.
But I'm puzzled by it because what about the crash retrieval reports?
And the bodies, yeah. And believe me when I say this, folks, there is extensive information about those bodies. They have been studied for years, and I am hoping that if there is another release of information, it will finally be about the bodies. You know, I've decided in my next book, I'm just going to write about them. I can't prove anything. But I have a lot of detailed information about these bodies, and they are exactly that, bodies. So I don't see if they're from another dimension, another physical universe that's perhaps a mirror universe. I'm quite sure such a thing exists. I don't see that they would leave bodies here. Exactly. I think or how they would be here in terms of physicality. It's just very
curious. If you look at the whole Bigfoot phenomena, there does seem to be an interdimensional aspect to that too. And I've kind of come to the conclusion that interdimensional beings, describing them that way, is not particularly useful because what isn't interdimensional? We ourselves have an interdimensional aspect in terms of a soul or a dream body or an astral body that moves on to higher dimensions. And I think the ETs have mastered that. So we see a lot of what looks like, quote, supernatural activity in terms of levitating ETs and walking through walls and disappearing and these sort of things.
Well, now these things could be technology.
Exactly.
In other words, there could be As I recall, we had a situation at our cabin once where it was very clear that there was an invisible being in there, and it was using a technology to remain invisible. I believe I described this extensively in my book, Transformation. So that certainly possible if someone can control gravity, which they obviously can. If you see these ships flying around. They can also do things like bend light. And if you can bend light, you can make yourself completely invisible. You can just move the light that's coming from behind you around yourself. And that was what was going on that night in our cabin. Now, if you have technologies that make you able to disappear and walk through walls and so forth, it's going to look like you're from another dimension when actually you're hiding out in the woods. Exactly.
I once had a couple from Illinois contact me who were describing haunting activity. I'm like, well, this sounds like a ghost. Because the doors were opening and closing and things like this, footsteps. And they're like, but there's this UFO hovering over our house at night. I'm like, oh, gosh. I mean, it's not always easy to tell what's going on.
Well, exactly. That happened at our cabin, and it happens to other people, too. Plenty of people who will be having what appear to be paranormal experiences and contact with the dead in a context where there's actually a UFO a few feet away, up 100 feet above their house, and they don't see that. Or they do see it, or someone other witness sees it. But and this gets me to this question. The dead are involved in this. And somehow, because when we at the cabin, whenever the dead would show up before or during multiple witness close encounter experiences at the cabin, what do you make of that? And do you have any cases? I think I may have read one of the cases that where there was a connection between the dead and the entities.
It does come up. It's pretty rare. I find that a lot of contactees are very reluctant to talk about some of these super high strangeness aspects, which is why I really wanted to embrace that in this book. And I keep having contactees call me back and say, well, no, I heard you say this. Now I'm going to tell you. I'm like, well, shoot, I could have put that in the book. That did come up with a gentleman I interviewed who was in a previous book, actually. His name is Don Anderson, whose father passed away, and he saw his father, deceased, on board a craft. So I think this is a situation where the ETs are able to communicate with deceased people in a very easy way.
Yeah. And
perhaps, because when people are taken on board a craft, it's in some ways a lot like a near-death experience. And they might actually be in a higher dimension when you're on that craft, and what we would think of as the other side, which would make communication with deceased people perfectly natural. So I think that's perhaps the mechanics behind what's going on. I'm speculating, but there's enough cases now where I think we have to take a serious look at these kinds of experiences, because a lot of people are describing them.
Yeah, and there is even one case where a witness shot an ET and shot the ET, and the ET blew up, exploded into this sort of liquid material that evaporated. But then the witness was haunted by the ET's ghost. Oh, which was outraged. And of course he was outraged because it had lost the body, but it didn't. I don't think you could say that it felt like it had been killed. And I'm wondering if they just don't have the same relationship to reality that we do. Some of them, at least, that, to them, the body is simply a tool to be used to be in this level of reality. And the soul is where they really live. And in which case, the whole question of are they from other planets or not just becomes kind of meaningless.
Yeah, well, I was talking to Dolly Saffron about this, actually, and she says when the ETs die, it's not a big deal. And they come, they're reborn, and they actually remember all their past lives, which is something we're just beginning to do. And it echoed some of what other contactees were telling me, like one lady who reached out to her main ET contact, a gray that calls himself Sen, and she started reaching the souls of deceased grays who had passed on from genetic hybridization programs that didn't work out. So these were all her children who were the ghosts of grays, presumably on the other side. So, I mean, this is what I'm talking about, high strangeness. There's this weird sort of assumption, I think, that UFO contact is all about being pulled on board and physically examined and let go. It's much more than that.
Right. No one's going to make this effort to come here and abduct somebody just to fool around with them for a few minutes and send them back. It's a bigger deal than that. But also, whatever's here is very good at controlling memory. In other words, this is why multiple witness events are so important, because I think it's probably harder to control the memories of a group of people who can then compare what they saw. So you have something else going on. And let's talk a little bit about hybrids. But before we do that, we're going to take a final break. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. UnknownCountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
We're talking to Preston Dennett, his new book, Humanoids and High Strangeness. Preston himself is a humanoid, and he's pretty strange, and so am I. So we're doing pretty good together. And let's now talk about this. And what are your thoughts, or have you had?
On the whole hybrid program?
The hybrid, yeah.
Yeah, well, there's no doubt in my mind that this is going on. One of my very first cases way back in 1988 involved a family who was involved with this, and it was the daughter who was having most of the experiences, but the mother was pulled on board and shown the babies, told to hold them, give them love, that they needed love. This was your typical, quote, baby presentation. And I've talked to dozens of contactees, at least, who have had this experience.
Yeah, my wife and I had it.
Yeah, people react in different ways. Some are like, oh, they're overjoyed, like, this is my child. Others are like, horrified, like, they did not give permission for this. And they're a little bit repulsed or have some revulsion towards the appearance of these children, but at the same time have a strong maternal or paternal attraction to them. And I've talked to some people, Dolly Saffron is one, but many. There was another, the same lady I mentioned up in Maine, who met her full-grown adult hybrid son. So this is an ongoing relationship that a lot of contactees have with children who are living with the ETs, who become adults at some point. Absolutely, this is a thing. One of the most extraordinary cases I had involved a couple from Canada who had a missing fetus at 7.5 months. And the wife was actually fine with it. She says, I know my child is safe. They're living, she's living with the ETs, and got a chance to see her. The husband was very upset and couldn't understand why his wife was like, this is fine, don't worry. He's like, no, we just lost your child. They knew. I mean, they sent me the medical reports of her pregnancy. This is well verified. So that was an extraordinary case in terms of, you know, how long the pregnancy went. Usually this occurs
7 months is a long time before disappearing fetuses usually take place in the first or second trimester.
Exactly. But yeah, 3-4 children missing pregnancies is not unusual among female contactees. But this happens to men as well. There was a guy from upstate New York who was taken on board. It was his one and only fully conscious contact because he had so much missing time. The ETs brought him on board and said, you need to know why we contacted you. Here is your child. Aren't you happy? He's like, no, I'm not happy. This is really upsetting. He was very upset about it. But at the same time, he loved this child.
So did the child look human or?
Half human, half gray.
Gray.
I think the grays are essentially human in genetically speaking.
Finally, someone says that. The answer, I think, is absolutely right. Yeah. I think the grays are essentially human. Do you think they're from the future?
I don't. I mean, I scoured the literature to find cases that would absolutely support that. And you can find a few. But I don't think that they're... They can certainly time travel. I mean, the things they can do with time are unbelievable.
Incredible stuff.
I've had some experiences myself. You know, I did have a missing time encounter, which I completely forgot. I've had memories of being on board. But there was one time I was just dead set. I needed to find out who these grays are. I need to know. And I just meditated. And I had probably my one and only true, quote, download, where I was just lying in bed and information poured into my brain in an instant. And it took me a while to unravel it. But basically what it showed was a human-looking male, very much like your average person, hair, you know, brown eyes, facial hair. And it started flipping through images where the man lost his hair, started to lose his facial features, and the head grew larger. And it took about 60 or 70, I guess you'd call them generations, or images, where it transformed into a complete typical gray. And the message was, we are human. And what we're dealing with here is genetic damage, which is certainly what many contactees have told me. And the story is sometimes a little different in its details, but genetic damage due to actual manipulation, or perhaps radiation, or perhaps a war on their planet way, way, way back. But another sort of indication that we're dealing with humans. And a couple of cases I have, the ETs, the gray said, we looked just like you. And they're trying to bring that back. So.
Yeah, I can well understand that. Given what they look like now, if they once looked like us and still have that same aesthetic. And, you know, that reminds me of something fascinating and personal. I remember how the old lady who came to the house so much thought us beautiful, and how she hated the slightest thought that would, if a slight thought crossed my mind, that how aesthetically challenged she was, let's put it that way, she would scream, she would go, ow, like I had slapped her in the face physically. And I think there may be something in that, because they do not think themselves beautiful, but I think they do think us beautiful.
Well, that's
even me.
Yeah, I think all of us have a little bit of that. I mean, we can see that with how rampant cosmetic surgery is. People are constantly trying to adjust their appearance and makeup.
I see too many women being turned into basilisks or statues, their faces ceased to function. We had a friend we'd known for years, and she'd gotten a lot of plastic surgery and sort of been in hiding. And we saw her walking down a sidewalk, and I didn't recognize her at all, but Anne did. And she said hello to us, and I looked at her. I couldn't think who it was. And Anne recognized her, and they talked for a moment, and she had occasion to laugh. And when she laughed, her face didn't change. The laughter came out, but her face was like, ha, 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 ha. I was terrified. we're going a little off subject here, and I'm sorry, I apologize, folks. But let's get back to the cases. There's a wonderful story that you have about an ET on a bicycle. And, you know, pre-side, we've come to the end of your time with us. And so get on your bicycle and bicycle over to unknowncountry.com and do two things. Get Preston's book, definitely. Get it on unknowncountry.com, Humanoids and High Strangeness. So you could just go to Amazon and get it, or get it wherever books are sold. But do get it, because it's a really good read. And it, like all of this reading, it's enjoyable and it's fascinating, but it has a deeper purpose. And that is that it gets your mind used to this level of experience. So as we get deeper into it and closer to it, we're going to become better at handling it. And it's books like this that help us the most. Humanoids and High Strangeness by Preston Dennett. We'll see you next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.